Hey guys, my name is That Quiet Kid, and today we are going to do week 8 assignment of NPTEL Ethical Hacking course. So the first question is, which of the following statements correctly represents the term steganography? So hiding information within some cover media file like an image file or a music file or any other file is basically represents steganography. So which of the following is are not instances of behavioral biometrics? So this signature and gate, we have signature, you know, by signature you can determine the handwriting, and gate is basically a way by which a person walks. So these are two the instances of behavioral biometrics, and the fingerprint, iris scan and retina scan are of biological biometrics. So these fingerprint, the iris scan and retina scan are not the instances of behavioral biometrics. Consider a color image of size 2000 into 2000 where each pixel is 24 bits. How many bits of information can be hidden in the image by using LSB steganography technique? So to answer this question, you have to multiply this 2000 into 2000, which will give you 40 lakh, and each pixel is stored in 24 bits. But how many bytes? You see the difference here? It is asking the information in bytes. So we'll have to convert this into bytes first. This 24 divided by 8, which will give us 3. So 3 into 40 lakh will be 1 crore 20 lakh, and we have to now divide this whole by 8 as well, because we have to convert this 2000 into 2000. This size is also into bits, and we have to convert this into byte. So we divide this 1 crore 20 lakh by 8, and our answer is 15 lakh bytes. So none of these will be the answer for this question. Let's move on to fourth. Which of the following statement is are true for biometric systems? For authentication application, a user template is compared against all possible stored template stored in the database. This is not correct. For authentication, we know that when it comes to authentication, we know that the user exists. So we have to, you know, compare it against that particular individual which the user presents that he is. So it is wrong. For verification, we have to, you know, verify it from the long database of users. But for here it is written that for verification, a user template is compared against a specific. It is also incorrect. They provide 100% accuracy. It is also incorrect. So none of these is the correct answer for question number 4. Fifth is, which is denial of service attack? An attack that prevents legitimate users from accessing some service. So this is B part is the correct. How does Smurf denial of service work? So how this works is, attacker sends a ping request impersonating as, you know, some user, and send it to the, you know, the broadcast address, so that it goes to all the machines in the network. But here it is written that a ping request is sent from the victim's machine to a broadcast address, which is, I don't think it is correct, because we don't use the victim machine. We spoof his IP address and send it using his IP address. You know, we try to say that we are this IP address, and we, you know, want to ping, check if this, you know, is alive or not. These machines are alive or not. So I think it should be none of these, because we use victim's IP, not his machine. So I think none of these should be the answer. Which of the following attacks rely on the accumulation of TCP half open connections on the server? So sync flooding attack is the attack which relies on accumulation of TCP half open connections on the server. So what happens is, we send lots of sync requests, synchronization requests to the server using some random IPs, so that this victim machine replies to these various random IP addresses that we have just sent. But those various IP addresses, random IP addresses that we used, they didn't, you know, ask for anything. So when this server will respond to them with this sync acknowledgement packet, they won't know what to do with it, because they didn't ask for anything. So this is actually how a sync flooding attack works. We send sync request, synchronization request, using some random IPs, and the server responds to those random IPs, and you know, this is how they flood. It's kind of a denial of service attack. Which of the following is are true for botnet? A large number of botnets are often used to attack a victim machine. It is correct. It is a malicious software that spreads from one machine to another. It is not. Botnet is made using, you know, through viruses or worms. because we take control of botnets. Is basically a connection of computers. So this is a botnet is made using viruses or worm, but it is not itself a malicious software that spreads from one computer to another. So it can be used to mount distributed denial of service attack. It is used to mount distributed DDoS attack. So what is meant by recursive name resolution? So a host may have to send multiple DNS requests to several DNS servers. So this is an iterative name resolution, and a host sends a single DNS request to its next higher level DNS server. So what happens in recursive name resolution is a client, when we have to convert the name of the website into IP address, it goes to a server, DNS server, and if it cannot find, it goes to the next higher level DNS server, and if cannot, it also cannot find, it goes to the next higher. So this continues until it finds out, the website to the IP address, and then it returns back to the host. So I think B part should be the answer for this. And how does PGP, pretty good privacy, provide security in email transmissions? So it provides authentication and confidentiality, but it does not provide non-repudiation and availability. It provides compression. It provides, it compresses, and it also, uses sometimes Base64 for, protection, but it does not provide us non-repudiation. Non-repudiation means we cannot deny that we have sent this data, and availability means the data is available. So I think A part is the answer for the 10th question, and that completes my week 8 assignment of NPTEL ethical hacking, and thank you for watching.